Good morning, everybody. I hope you've all had a lovely last night's sleep and good rest to grab in all the information for the day. So welcome again for the early morning session. And we have with us Ms. Lisa Jain. I'm sure you all are aware of who Lisa Jain is, and she's a country representative of College Board. So your SATs, your APs, your PSATs. So she knows it all, and she has it all. Welcome, Lisa.
Thank you so much. And a special thank you for waking up so early to come and listen to me. I barely got out of bed myself, so I know how hard this must have been. So thank you so much for coming in. I'll be packing in a lot of information today because I only get this one opportunity to tell you everything that we do to help schools. I'll start off talking about some mobility trends of Indian students, which I think could be interesting information for schools as well as higher ed members to have because College Board has access to a lot of data, so we're sharing some of that with you. I'll spend a few minutes talking about the redesigned SAT, some sort of basic things that you may not know about in the new exam. I'll talk after that about a lot of free resources that the College Board has that can be very helpful for counselors that you may not be familiar with, right? So before doing any of that, just a quick show of hands so I know who I'm talking to. How many school counselors here? Okay, a big number in the audience that we have. School heads or teachers? Okay, and higher ed members? Okay, fantastic. I think for the higher ed members, I'll probably pick upon you during the presentation just to sort of talk about university policies related to the SAT, especially when I talk about some of the options that come along with the new SAT. But before I start, just very quickly on who the College Board is. The College Board started all the way in 1900, so it's a very old organization. It started off in the United States. The purpose of the College Board really was to standardize some of the admissions practices for US universities. Because much like India is today, I believe the US system used to be extremely different in the way students used to apply to colleges. They're still fiercely independent, which results in very high quality, but they have standardized some of the ways in which universities look at student admissions. And the College Board was born out of that idea. The SAT was born out of that idea. Of course, it's evolved over time. We do a lot of other things to help schools. We're a membership organization, which means that we actually serve universities who are our members. That also means that we're constantly in touch with universities, engaging with them to take feedback about our programs and improve it so that they continue to be meaningful to them as they make admissions decisions, right? So quickly showing you the agenda, I've already gone over it. So we'll just kick off. There's been a consistent increase in the number of international students, which means students from outside the US studying in the United States at the undergraduate level. No surprises there. The elephant in the room is obviously China. It's a big red gap, you know, the chunk that you can see is all China. What's really happened is that the rest of the world, apart from the seven countries highlighted here, their growth has been sort of flat. It's really these seven countries listed here that have contributed to mobility towards the United States in the last few years. India is part of that. It's not as big as China because, as we all know, India continues to be a very big postgraduate market, but undergraduate numbers are increasing. At a small rate, perhaps, but they are increasing steadily. And that's something that's important for counselors to know because you'll probably see that trend in your schools. You have more and more students who are interested in applying overseas looking at the United States as their first option. We got hold of an interesting survey which talks about the universities in the US that receive the highest number of SAT scores across different countries. There's a lot of common names across the four countries on this slide right now. The interesting thing, though, is that the names which weren't common, India was very unique in them. If you look at some of the names of universities which Indian students are sending their SAT scores to, but not students from China or Vietnam or Kuwait, you'll see that these are predominantly highly selective competitive universities to get into. And that's sort of reflective of our culture. We are a very competitive country. We do tend to apply to places that are much harder to get into, and our aspirations are in line with that. So this is not very surprising information, but it's interesting to see that although there's a lot of overlap, what really stands out is the kind of institutions that your students are applying to. Let's talk a little bit about aid and how students are funding their studies in the US. For a majority of international students, the funding is self-funding, right? So they are relying on personal and family funds to be able to support themselves in the US. There is some scholarship available either from organizations within your country or with US universities helping you out, but predominantly the focus is still on self-funding. And that's again reflective of why maybe the numbers from India aren't as high as we think they should be or want them to be for US studies. If you look at the different levels of importance that students from around the world attach to the availability of financial aid from universities, if you look at South and Central Asia, it's extremely important to our students to have the opportunity to get aid. Right, because it's expensive. It's really expensive to study in the US if you don't get aid. So it continues to be a very, very important factor for African, South and Central Asian countries, not so much for some of the other countries that you look at. The good news is that more and more universities are providing aid. So if actually more than the numbers, if you look at the amount of aid that's available, that's what's really gone up. So if you look at the number of universities that continue to provide aid, it's been almost static. There's not been that much change. But if you look at the amount of aid in millions of dollars that is going out to international students, that's increased in the past year, right? And that's good news for all our students in India and internationally. The last trend that I really want to point you to before talking about the redesigned SAT is this is the good news. About 1 in 6 international students do receive some form of aid. Maybe a small amount, maybe a very large amount, but aid is definitely available. And I think for a lot of universities that are present here that you can interact with, it's a great option to ask them about the kind of scholarships and aid that they provide to your students, right? These may be universities that you're not already too familiar with, but that doesn't matter. The high quality of institutes that's available in the US and in other parts of the world, definitely worth your while talking to them, understanding the opportunities available for your students at their universities. For a lot of us, the schools that we run, the schools that we're a part of, are not catering only to a certain cross-section of the affluent parts of society. It's important for us to develop this idea that international education is not just for those of us who can afford to pay. A lot of us can actually use the resumes that we have to get really good scholarships at universities. And that's really the point that we want to drive home with the trends that we've just shown you. Let's move on to the redesigned SAT. I'm going to spend just 5 to 6 minutes talking about what the new exam looks like and some of the things that you need to know as counselors and school heads about it. The SAT has always been a skill-based assessment. It tests skills in key areas, which universities have told us are very, very important for students to have if they want to succeed in college and later in life. And in the redesign happened in March this year. In India, we saw the administration of the first redesigned exam in the month of May, so we've had 2 admins already. In the redesigned exam, we continue to focus on those skills. It's just that the structure of the exam has changed a little bit. So earlier, the exam used to be scored out of 2,400. We've moved that to 1,600 points. 800 for math, 800 for a section we call evidence-based reading and writing. The essay is now optional in the SAT, right? And this was really based on feedback where a lot of universities that use the Common App, some of them came and told us that students are submitting enough essays to us, and we don't really need the SAT essay to tell us more about the student. Then there were other universities that said, no, the SAT essay gives us a completely different perspective and we'd continue to use it. And that's why we made it optional. So universities decide whether they want students to submit scores with or without the essay. And I'll talk to you a little bit about where most of the universities stand on that. So the total exam, the SAT, it's a long exam. And very often students are not prepared for that length if they haven't practiced enough. I wouldn't call it a difficult assessment, but to have continued focus for 3 hours on multiple choice questions is not as easy as it sounds for students. And often students are surprised by that the first time they take the assessment, right? So it's something that you should inculcate in them is to practice a lot so that they're not unprepared when they go in for the SAT, right? The duration of the exam hasn't changed much. It used to be 3 hours, 45 minutes. Now, if you're taking it without the essays, 3 hours, with the essays, 3 hours, 50 minutes. So it hasn't changed that much. What has changed is the emphasis on the essay. It used to be only 25 minutes of the exam. It's now 50 minutes because students will actually be reading a passage before attempting to write an essay. So there's more time for reading incorporated in that. I want to spend a few minutes talking about some of the themes in the SAT, which I think are interesting for schools to know. The first one is words in context. How many of you have heard students complain about the weird words that they had to learn up just for the exam, right? I think even universities know about it. The SAT was infamous for that. I often joke to students that the words that used to appear on the exam, your English teacher has probably never heard of, right? The good news is that's gone away. The kind of vocabulary that's tested on the SAT now is words that students are expected to use in daily academic life. Nothing out of the world, nothing out of this planet, stuff that you're expected to be comfortable with. So that's one big change, which I think is great news for Indian students especially, because this is one place where we used to really struggle as Indian students. The second one is command of evidence. What we've done in the SAT, and this is sort of in line with where curriculum across the world is moving, is it's not just important to come up with the right answer, it's also important to be sure of the process that you've gone through to come up with that answer, right? The process of reaching there is very important. What we've done on the SAT now is we've got something called linked questions, right? For instance, there could be a passage that you read, and the following question could be, what is the author's tone in this passage, right? And you have options you choose from. The follow-up question could be, which part of this passage made you think this is the author's tone? So you're not just telling us what you think the answer is, you're also proving why you think it is. You're providing evidence for your answers, right? And that's gonna be a theme that's present in the SAT now. The essay I'm gonna talk about later, so I'll skip that at this point. Math that matters most. What we've done is we've identified 3 broad areas in math that we want to focus on, which is algebra, problem solving, and complex functions, if I remember the term correctly. It's not difficult for students who are not doing math in 11 to do well on the SAT math. They do require a little extra support and help, but there's no reason to believe that if you've dropped math in school, you can't attempt SAT math. That's not true. So it's going to be deeper focus on a lesser number of topics going forward. The other big change in math is that earlier the calculator was allowed throughout the math section of the SAT. We now have different sections. Some of them allow the calculator and some of them don't. Nothing, again, for Indian students to worry about because we're pretty good at doing math without calculator because we do that all our school lives. The fifth and sixth theme, which is problems grounded in real-world context and analysis in sciences, history, and social studies, really speaks to the fact that the SAT is a skill exam. You don't need to have prior knowledge about any passage or any information that you see on the exam. However, you need to have the comfort to be able to read information from a variety of different topics and subjects and be able to make sense of it and answer questions on the basis of that. So even if you're not studying science in school, that's fine. You only have to give your answers based on the information provided to you. So the information or the passage could be from chemistry or from philosophy or from history, it doesn't matter. You just need the skills to answer that. What we mean by real world context is that information today is presented to us in a lot of different ways. It's not just written passages. There are infographics, there are graphs, there are tables. So on the SAT going forward, students will encounter information presented to them in different ways. And again, they just need to have the skill to be able to read information and make sense of it, right? And write about it. The seventh one, US founding documents in the great global conversation. This sometimes tends to make people outside the US very anxious. I can see a lot of university reps smiling for that. all this point talks about is that going forward on the SAT, there will be one or two passages that have speeches or writings from important world leaders in the United States and outside the United States. So it could be an interesting speech made by Margaret Thatcher or Nelson Mandela or the governor of Texas or Mahatma Gandhi. These are going to talk about important issues that students should be comfortable reading about: equality, slavery, women's rights, humanity, the environment, right? Again, no prior knowledge required, just the ability to read complex passages which are important to the world and make sense of it. The last one with the smiley face, we've removed negative marking from the exam. A lot of students tend to think that means that the SAT is easier. Not really. It's a standardized exam. Chances are if you're finding something easier, the rest of the world is finding it easier as well. So it won't really have impact on the difficulty level. However, it will encourage students to be less fearful of choosing an answer if they're not completely sure of it. And that's fine. We don't want to penalize students for doing guesswork, right? So that's really sort of the themes on the SAT that I wanted to highlight to you. We talked about the essay becoming optional. What does that really mean? It means that universities have come up with their own individual policies on if they require the essay, recommend the essay, or don't require or recommend the essay. I'll quickly go around the US universities that we have with us to talk about their policies. Add your test optional, but if you require, if somebody gives you the SAT score, you don't need the essay. All right. What about anyone else here from the US? Yes.
We require the SAT or ACT, but we don't require the essay at all.
Okay, fantastic. Yes?
We do not require the optional essay either, Drexel University.
Okay, fantastic. So that's three universities here. None of them require the essay. And you'll see that. You'll see that about 77% of universities in the United States or outside the US who use the SAT don't require or recommend the essay. However, there's a caveat to that when you look at international students. The set of universities that international students, and that includes our Indian students who tend to apply to very competitive schools as well, 48% of them continue to either require or recommend the essay. So chances are that your students are probably going to be applying to a combination of universities, some of whom may require or recommend it. So there's still a very high chance that even though it's optional, as an international student, you're probably going to take the SAT with the essay. And it's important for you to note that students should do research on the set of universities that they hope to apply to. And if none of them require the essay, it's probably okay for them to not attempt it, right? And it's important to note that. On the new SAT, we're providing very, very detailed scoring to students to help them really understand their SAT performance. And should they wish to take the exam again, this will really help them narrow down on where they've gone wrong, where they need to focus their energies to improve their SAT score. So there's going to be the total score out of 1600. The essay scored separately, I'll talk about that later, which is broken down into the math and reading and writing sections. Besides that, we'll be providing students with a lot of sub-scores. The idea of the sub-score is to really narrow down on different skill levels or different areas and subjects that the test is coming up with questions for, right? For instance, if you look at the bottom of the slide, the heart of algebra in light blue, right? Say on this particular SAT, there were 25 questions related to algebra, and the student notices they've only got 12 of them right. Instantly they know, this is a problem area for me. I need to focus a lot more on algebra questions if I have any hope of improving my score. We don't expect universities to use this data right now because the exam is too new and there's not enough statistical evidence to say that this is going to provide them with meaningful information to make admissions decisions. However, in the next few years, that might change and some universities might want to look at some of the subscores to see what that tells them about the students' particular areas of skills and subject interests, right? But not right now. The essay, as I told you, is going to be scored separately because it's optional now. There's going to be a score on three distinct transparent components on the SAT. Reading, analysis, writing, each of them scored on a scale of 8 points. this is a big change for us because students know exactly how they've scored on different skills being tested in the essay. So there's a lot of transparency going forward. The way the essay is going to work is that there's a common prompt that's publicly available, and I'll show you what that prompt is. The prompt basically tells students what they need to do with the essay. The big change is that the emphasis in scoring is going to be the analysis made by the student and not on which side of the argument they are on, right? And that's very important to note. It's just on the analysis, their understanding of what the essay is. This is the prompt that's available to students. I'm not going to read it out, and I'll be happy to share the presentation with who wants it later. But the idea really is to provide evidence to support the claim they are making, to use reasoning to develop ideas in the essay, and to use persuasive elements such as word choice, grammar, vocabulary, to add power to the ideas that they're trying to express. So you read a passage and then form analysis based on that. This is a common prompt. It will not change. What will change is the actual essay or passage given to the student in the exam based on which they'll be writing their essay. There's been a lot of anxiety about us changing the SAT, and that's understandable. Whenever there's something new, nobody wants to be the guinea pig. They want to wait out a few administrations before they decide to take the exam, and that's natural. I think that happens to anyone, anywhere when the exam changes. It's important to note that we change the SAT roughly once every decade. And the reason we make that change is to make sure that the exam continues to be meaningful to admissions officers as they use it, if they use it, to make admissions decisions, right? So all the changes that have been made on the SAT reflect feedback from universities to become a better exam for the purpose that it serves. We did a survey in the United States after the first administration to get feedback on what the new SAT is like to students. And overwhelmingly, we heard good things, right? I won't go through all of these, but just some of the things that really stood out. 80% of the students said that the vocabulary that we were testing on the new SAT was more useful, which is not very surprising, right? 75% of them said that the reading tests were either at the same difficulty level or probably slightly easier than the older version of the exam. 59% of the students said that the skills that we were testing in math were probably going to be more useful to them in college life, right? So overall, we've heard good things, and I don't have data to prove this, but a lot of schools in the last 2 months have come up to me from India and told me they were surprised by how well their students have done on the new SAT. And I know there are a few counselors in this room who've actually heard that from students as well. They've come and told me about it. The reason I'm talking about this is because there is fear about what the new exam really means. I think it's important for us as school counselors and heads to tell our students there's nothing to worry about. It's a transparent exam. It's meant to be more useful for admissions officers. It's also meant to align better with the work that you do in schools. It's a skill test. As a school, you're probably already inculcating all these skills in your students from younger classes, so there's really nothing for students to worry about if they have to take the SAT to apply to college. How many of you have heard of Khan Academy or used Khan Academy resources in school or outside? I think most of you have heard of it, even if you don't use it. I'll tell you a little bit about the work that we're doing with Khan Academy for SAT prep. Before that, I think it's important for you to know that a lot of schools around the world and a lot of teachers around the world use this guide. You can just take down the name. You'll probably be able to Google it and find it. It's a very big 90-page PDF document. It's a teacher implementation guide for the redesigned SAT. It basically includes a lot of information on the kind of skills that we test on the exam so that if teachers would like, if they are motivated, they can actually include some of those outcomes and skills in the way they teach their classes in school so that students are more prepared for a standardized test, which is important to their college application. So this is a completely free resource available to teachers and school heads around the world that you can use. It has great information on the essay scoring. So there are different sample essays given. It tells you how much that would have scored and gives you reasoning behind that score. So very, very helpful information for counselors and school heads. we tied up with Khan Academy to provide a very high quality test preparation resource to students around the world. And the reason we did that is to equal the level playing field, right? Some students will take test prep, expensive test prep. Some others choose to study on their own. Some can afford to pay for test prep, some can't. The idea behind our collaboration with Khan Academy was to provide very, very high quality resources for students to be able to prepare for the SAT completely free of cost anywhere in the world if they have an internet access. There's thousands and thousands of practice questions in the redesigned SAT available. This is obviously very high quality and authentic because they worked with the test maker to develop these materials, right? So it's important to note that irrespective of any other resources that a student may choose to use, it's great for them to supplement that with Khan Academy resources because it's high quality. We have 4 full-length practice tests available for students as well, and these are actually timed in the real sense. So if you're doing it online, the section will sort of vanish once the time for it is over. So it's real world. You can also print off and do it just on regular pen and paper the way you would do the real exam. There's lots of videos to explain different concepts, classic Khan Academy style. There are hints on questions. There's recommendations to students on which skill areas they should practice more of depending on their diagnostic performance. Lots and lots of things to help students and to help teachers. So we have an educator login on Khan Academy, so teachers can actually use this if they want to help students prepare for the SAT in class. The last thing we have, and this is more for students, is we actually have a free app available on Android and Apple phones as well. Because kids are spending all their time on mobile phones now, this is just a great way to engage them continuously for practice. You can actually take exam papers, print them off, circle off the answers on the OMR sheet, take a phone, scan the answer sheet, and upload it back, and we'll score that for you. It's completely free of cost. It's pretty cool technology that's been integrated into the test prep, right? Students can also download this app again for free and have one daily practice question sent to them that they can practice from. So just sort of additional ways to keep students interested and practicing for the exam, that's very important. I will talk about the PSAT later, but just so you know, for schools who do the PSAT or preliminary SAT, students can take their PSAT results from the College Board online account, send it to the Khan Academy account that they create, and Khan Academy will do statistical analysis and use intelligence to throw out practice suggestions to the student, which is customized to the student based on their performance on the PSAT. Again, completely free of cost. You don't pay anything for that. I'll spend maybe about 5 to 7 minutes talking about some of the resources which are free or very inexpensive, which can help counselors and schools in the work that they do with students. And I think during the Q&A, I'm going to ask some of our higher ed members to give thoughts around some of these. The first one that I'll talk about is getting an international school code. Which is also called a SEEP code, which I think would be very helpful to the admissions officers in the room. An international school code, how many of your schools don't have one, or you're not familiar with this terminology? A few of you in the room. So for the others, my apologies, I'll spend 2 minutes educating the ones in the room who need this information. It's essentially a 6-digit identity assigned to your school by the College Board for no charge at all. It's an identity that stays with you for life. For Indian schools, it starts with the word, with the number 6, 7, and then there's 4 more digits after that, which are unique to you. The International School Code is used by organizations outside the College Board as well. So the Common App, for instance, uses the school code. The ACT, which is an alternative to the SAT, when students register for that, they also use our school code. And that's simply because it's been around for so long that it doesn't really make sense to come up with a parallel numbering system, right? What is the purpose of the school code? Number of benefits for schools and students. One, when your students are applying for standardized tests, they're asked to choose the school that they study at. In the absence of your school having a code, they have to choose something called 000000, right? When students choose your school, when they're registering for an exam, the school actually receives the official score reports from the test maker. Right, so students get their copy of their SAT results. You as a school will receive the results of all the students in your school who took the SAT, provided they identify that code when registering, right? Again, when students are applying to universities, either through the Common App or independently, they're again asked to identify which school they come from. And the school code is very important for universities. And I'll give you an example of why it becomes so meaningful. It sounds like a strange idea. Why can't you just go with the name? We've all heard of the school called DPS Arkepuram, right, in Delhi. If I did an exercise right now and asked all of you to write down DPS Arkepuram on paper, you would all write it differently. Some of you might write DPS together. Some of you might write it with dots. Some of you might write it with spaces. Some of you might have spaces between R and K as well. Some of you might write it together. That'll make it very hard for universities to collate all information from a single school in one place. The code helps them record information systematically about a school and use it over the years. And I'm sure the admissions officers will vouch for this later in the Q&A. A lot of universities use information from the past about the kind of students that have applied to them from a school when they're planning their outreach activities in a country, right? So for example, Ed here from Rollins, if he's been receiving fantastic applications from one Indian school, the next time he visits India, he'll probably want to go do a presentation at the school and talk to the students there. And this record building that the school code allows you to do becomes very critical for you as a school if you want to attract more higher ed members and have them know about your school in the long term, right? So these are really the different reasons. The other sort of obvious reason is that the College Board requires you to get this code if you want to administer any of our assessments in school. So if you want to become a school that offers AP courses, or if you want to administer the PSAT, or if you want to apply to become an SAT test center, you require a school code. The process for getting this is extremely simple. Just get in touch with me after this. I'll give you my email address. Write to me saying you want a school code. I'll send you the application form. It's a very, very simple two-page form you need to fill out with information like your school address, how many teachers do you have, do you have a storage area where you can lock exams, very simple stuff. You send that back to me over email. We take about 2 to 3 weeks to assign the school code to you. It's as simple as that. No cost associated with it. The other free resource I want to talk to you about is something called Big Future. Anyone here who's familiar with Big Future and has used it in the past? Yes. Big Future is just a free resource to help counselors navigate the thousands of choices that are available to their students, right? I like to call it an online library of information about universities and colleges. It's got a very, very large number of US universities. I think all accredited US universities can be found in Big Future, as well as universities outside of the United States, right? The good thing, there are two or three good things about Big Future. One, that we get the information directly from the college or university, so it's authentic. As long as they are updating the information and sending it to us, we'll have the most recent information about them. The second thing is that it really helps students understand the concept of best fit. How do they do that? How do we do that at Big Future? Students can use this website to search information about different colleges based on the parameters that are most important to them, right? So we have no rankings available on Big Future at all, because we don't think rankings are a great idea to be doing your college search. Instead, students can say, I want to look at universities that offer international aid to students, are in the New York area, and have a finance course available. You add these filters and you'll be able to see the list of colleges and universities. And of course, that's a starting point. You can then go do more research on the university's website, get in touch with admissions officers. But this is a great place to start navigating that whole system, right? There's lots of videos, resources, tips available for students as well. Just helpful for them as they start planning for college and for college applications. How many schools here are doing the PSAT or are familiar with the PSAT? A lot of you already do it. Again, in the interest of boring you for a couple of minutes, I'm going to speak to the ones who don't know about the PSAT because I think it could be useful for some of the schools. What we've done at the College Board is we've created something called a sort of pathway, right, which helps students lead up to SAT in the most effective way. The PSAT stands for Preliminary SAT. So it's essentially a practice version of the SAT created by the test makers who created the SAT. The idea behind PSAT is to provide grade appropriate assessments to students from class 8 onwards. So there are two assessments available. One is called the PSAT 8-9, which is suitable for students in the 8th and 9th grade. And then there's PSAT NMSQT, which also has another name called PSAT 10. It's complex, but I'll explain to you what the difference is. And that's suitable for students in grades 10 and 11. NMSQT stands for a scholarship name which is granted by the National Merit Scholarship Association in the US. It's not applicable to Indian students. It's relevant to American citizens in your school, right? They actually, when they take the PSAT, they automatically qualify for the NMSQT scholarship run by this American agency. The PSAT NMSQT takes place in the month of October every year. There are three fixed dates given to schools. They choose one of the three dates that are suitable to them and they administer the PSAT NMSQT on that day. For some schools who are not able to use the October administration, there's a repetition of the same exam without the scholarship component, which we call PSAT 10. And that can be done in the spring following October. So there's a window available to you between Jan and March, and you can administer the PSAT 10 then if you've missed out on the NMSQT. That's sort of the technical difference. The PSAT 8-9, schools have a very flexible administration window. They can choose on any date in the fall or in the spring, depending on convenience. Why is the PSAT useful to some of your students? One, as I said, it's very, very good practice for the SAT because the exam is modeled exactly on the SAT, right? So the structure is the same, it's just grade appropriate in terms of difficulty level, right? It's very cost effective. So the PSAT NMSQT costs the school $19. The PSAT 8-9 costs you $14. It's about one-fifth or one-sixth the price of the SAT. So for a lot of students who tend to take the SAT early on, just to get acquainted with the exam, this is probably a much cheaper and better way of practicing, right? The big reason that I think the PSAT is extremely helpful to students in schools is that when you get the results back, it's got a very, very comprehensive analysis of your skills as an individual. Where have you done well? Where have you not done that well? So that from an earlier age, you understand where your skills are and more importantly, where your weaknesses are. So you can improve those in the next 2 or 3 years so that you're better prepared to do well on the SAT. In the Indian context, a lot of schools ask me, we don't have too many students doing the SAT. Is this still useful to us? Because it's pretty inexpensive, a lot of schools actually use this as a diagnostic assessment for their entire grade. Because even if you're not going to take the SAT and if you're planning to apply to Indian colleges, you'll be taking 10 different competitive exams. A lot of them are multiple choice. A lot of them focus on math, reading, and writing. So this is still good practice for your students if you think it's useful for them, right? What I get very excited about is the fact that the results that come back to schools can give really meaningful insights to counselors and to teachers. Right? So we provide you with information on results for the individual student, then how your students have done at a grade level and at a school level. Right? Imagine a math teacher for grade 9 notices that on one of the questions of the PSAT, she can see which question this is, 40 of her grade 9 students attempted it, 28 of them got that question wrong. That's a huge piece of information for her to have because it tells her, whenever I was explaining this concept, I missed the mark. I probably need to revisit this because a majority of my class did not understand what I was talking about, right? So you, if schools want, if teachers are motivated enough, you can use the PSAT results really to sort of add meaning to the teaching experience in your classrooms and really help improve some of the learning outcomes, right? There is a price component to the exam itself, which I told you about. All this reporting is free of cost. The school does not pay anything for it. The exam cost is borne by the student. All right? If you're interested in learning more about the PSAT, please come and talk to me later. I'll be happy to talk to you about it. I'll end my presentation with about 20 minutes to go. Just letting you know that we do a lot of professional development for teachers and counselors around the year. I personally am trying to do more free webinars. Right, so I just send out information about the webinar that I'm doing in 2 weeks' time to my entire network of schools. You just log on with a good internet connection and we'll just cover different topics of interest. So I'm trying to do that more frequently through the year now. We also do workshops for teachers in AP, right? So the good thing though is that even if your school's not teaching AP right now, a lot of the content that we cover in AP workshops tends to be very, very useful for teachers teaching CBSE, ISC, IB, or A-levels as well, right? So we do them in two different subjects every year. We've done it in the past year in physics and economics. This year, hopefully, we'll be doing something. This year or early next year, we'll hopefully do something for calculus and maybe English, right? So it could be great professional development for teachers. We try and keep this as inexpensive as possible because we want to encourage more teachers to participate. So it's usually less than 10,000 rupees, usually at a five-star hotel that includes the cost of the workshop, lunch, everything. This is the next workshop that's coming up, more suitable to counselors, of course, talking at a counseling conference. We do this every year. This is going to be the fourth year we're doing this. Fantastic opportunity. This is not a conference. This is a training workshop. What that means is 2 days of intensive training for counselors on every single aspect of US college admissions, right? So we spend an hour and a half talking about the counselor's recommendation letter, an hour and a half talking about how you build a fantastic school profile, talking about how transcripts have to be presented to US colleges, spending time navigating the Common App, talking about financial aid opportunities. The most exciting part of this workshop for me is the fact that it's not led, I don't sit and lecture you for 2 days. We actually get admissions officers from US universities to moderate the entire workshop. We're very fortunate this year to have some very, very experienced people coming down for our workshop in September. We have Jason, who's the Dean of Admissions at Cornell, has fantastic experience, is very familiar with India. He visits India once or twice a year. We have Doug, who's been in admissions for about 30 years now. He's with Vanderbilt. We have Dr. Evans, who is also very, very experienced in the field of admissions. She's from the University of Florida. We will have some other universities joining us as well, but they'll be leading the sessions for those 2 days. This is taking place in Gurgaon, 26th and 27th of September, at the Oberoi, priced at 7,500 rupees. That includes lunch. There's also a cocktail reception being hosted in the evening. We do this interesting thing called a mock admissions review session during this workshop. So essentially, Jason from Cornell hands out four applications of students, real applications of students that they received in the past couple of years at Cornell. We obviously take the names off and keep it anonymous. These are four Indian students from four Indian schools. You get together in teams of 10 or 12 counselors, and then you pitch for that student to get into Cornell. Right? And at the end of it, there's a whole review where you understand how admissions teams actually work, how they take decisions, how they discuss students, and then you'll come to know who actually got in and who didn't. Right? So it's a very, very exciting exercise to go through. It's as sort of real world as it gets to understand how admissions officers work. So that is the end of my presentation. The College Board does run an academic program called Advanced Placement, and I'm seeing more and more schools in India interested about it. I didn't think it was appropriate to talk about that in today's session because we were talking about counselor resources, but happy to talk about it later one-on-one if you need any information about AP. So thank you for your time. I hope that was useful. We have about 10 to 15 minutes for questions. Any feedback that universities want to give on some of the things I mentioned, like SAT, how you view it, the importance of a school code, what that helps you with, I'll be happy to hear from you as well. Yes. Okay. The College Board hasn't released public data yet on performance, so the actual results is something that we haven't released yet. It's still too early. Hopefully, after a few more admins, there will be country-level information available on how students are performing, what the average scores are, and all of that. However, we have released about 6 months ago something called a concordance table. Right? This table is available to every single university in the world who might be receiving scores from students who may have taken one attempt of the old SAT and are now taking one attempt of the new SAT. Right? The concordance table helps universities compare scores from the old SAT to the new SAT and the new SAT to the old SAT. Right? So this and the new SAT to the ACT. Right? So students have a very clear understanding of, okay, if I got 2150 in my old version, what does that really mean or equate to in the new SAT? So that information is publicly available on our website. anybody in the world has access to that. I would encourage you to use that so that students aren't getting flustered about how well or how badly they've done on the exam when they take it. It's helpful context. Any other questions at all, or discussions, or anything, any comments or feedback that you have? Anything from a higher ed perspective?
From the higher ed perspective, I think we're still evaluating. I know that these students are the new guinea pigs, so we're still kind of like seeing some schools, some universities are going with the new scores already and not converting. For example, for Rollins, we're converting the new score to the old score so we can do some comparison and maybe keep doing that probably for 2 or 3 years to see how they compare and so forth.
Fantastic. Yes. I'm not really sure that's how you perceive it, that it's a squeezed set of scores. Would anybody from higher ed want to comment on that, or do you want me to take the question?
Yes.
Using a concordance table that's been provided by the College Board, which has done a lot of statistical analysis to compare the old SAT score to the new score. A lot of statistical data analysis being done to decide exactly what a 1400 on the new SAT would equate to in a fair way to the old SAT score. So that data is available publicly to anyone in the world. That's completely standardized. We even go to the extent of comparing, as Shilpa said, the new SAT to the ACT, so that you have that context as well, which you use, I guess, all the time. There's an app, exactly. There's an app as well that you can use for that concordance. It's publicly available. To answer your question, the SAT used to be on 1600 when I gave it, right? So it changed to 2400 and it's gone back now. I think the way we've understood that universities are using this is that they're using, as Ed said, they prefer for some years to continue to equate to the old format. A lot of universities are very excited about the new format and they think it's brilliant and they just want to see it in that. Because it's a standardized test and because there's a percentile associated with your performance, I think that provides very, very helpful context to universities to see, you know, it might be a 15-20, but what does it really mean in percentile terms, right? And that'll continue to be important. I think that was important even on the old SAT. The percentile was always important. I didn't say the exam's easier. What I said is that students tend to think that it's easier because there's no negative marking, but that's probably not true. Having said that, I think there are certain components that have changed which I think make it slightly easier for Indian students, like the vocabulary becoming less complicated, I think is a huge boon for Indian students. Also, again, in my limited understanding, and Shilpa, I don't know if you want to step in to one or two students who've taken the exam. I've been hearing consistently that students are surprised by how well they're doing on the new SAT.
Especially students who are very, very strong at math. I've seen that trend in my school that they're doing exceptionally well at the SATs.
Okay.
Because 50% of it is math, right?
Yeah, I mean, earlier it used to be reading and writing 1600 and 800 math. Now it's 800 and 800. So,
strong math students are definitely doing well.
Really well. Okay, fantastic. Yes.
Just some feedback. We tried to do some of the concordances, also compared old SAT, new SAT with the same student. What we found was this, to share with all of you, was that, you know, as a lay person...
Let me just come by and give you a mic so everyone can hear you.
Thank you. Just to share some analysis we were trying to do with students who've done the May, June test, and we're waiting on the rest. So as a lay person who's not, who's, you know, whether you use or don't use a concordance in your mind, you think... 1500 should be a 2200 and a 1550 should be a 23. But when you actually look at the breakdown, because actually the critical reading and writing are now one component and the math is a good 50% of that chunk, it actually depends on how a student scores in each of these sections that will actually tell you where they stand. So we actually found that a 1500 is not necessarily a 2200 yet in many cases. But this depends on that skew. So I'm only sharing this. It's very early days. It could mean nothing as the months come by. And as all the data country-wise kind of comes up, will give us a better sense. But just to share the little bit we've done and seen. So we initially got excited, then we didn't. Then we said, well, it doesn't matter. It's still early days. We'll wait for the rest of the month.
Fantastic. Thanks, Iris. And I'll reiterate again that sort of loose connections equating a 1,500 to 2,200 may not be the most scientific way of looking at how universities will treat this. That concordance table really is scientifically done, and that's what universities are using. So I would encourage you as soon as possible to get your hands on that so that you have a very real comparison of what your score should look like if you're looking at a certain thing on the old score. So yeah. Any other questions at all? Yes.
Are the higher ed people going to be nervous about the new SAT compared to the ACT?
I will let higher ed answer that. I don't think they would, because all the feedback that we've taken is from them to improve the exam. But I'll let anybody from higher ed who wants to take this question. Are you nervous about the new SAT? You are? Well, your test optional.
We are, just because we don't know. And I think a lot of universities could say we don't know, and we're seeing scores to be higher, so we're a little bit nervous about it. So we just don't know. I think maybe my other colleagues in the room could see if they agree with me, but I think we're nervous. Friends that I've talked to and I've traveled with, we're just a little bit nervous because the scores are a little bit higher. And then it's also, I know a lot of counseling individuals had their kids take the old SAT before the new one launched. So, and they're just comparing and seeing. We've seen a lot of ACT, a lot more ACTs than before. I think a lot of counseling individuals are saying ACT.
There, you have it from higher ed, so I have nothing else to add to that. But I would encourage you to speak to a spectrum of admissions officers because that's not what we've heard, right? And I think a lot of higher ed members who maybe even been involved, universities that have been instrumental in driving some of that change, would probably have a different perspective, perhaps, to Ed. So I'd encourage you to speak about it a little bit more. The exam's been around for a long time. It's changed several times. This is not the first time this exam or any exam in the world has changed. So yes, it's going to go through transition. Students will be anxious for a few admins, but we actually haven't seen that reflected in students taking the SAT in our country. We've had plenty of students take the May and June admin. We'll continue to see them in October, November, December, and going forward. But speak to admissions officers to feel comfortable, I think. Anything else? Yes.
Hi, morning. I wanted to know, like, apart from the one you mentioned, are there any other Indian universities also who might want to accept?
Actually, there are more. Ashoka is looking at SAT scores. I think OP Jindal is looking at SAT scores as well. And there's a few others. I know Flame in Pune also accepts it. Yeah. Flame. Anyone else, Iris, that you're aware of?
So a number of the Indian sort of new private, especially the
A lot of the new privates take it.
We'll either say we accept it outright or we accept it and waive our own test.
Yeah.
Or if you have a certain cutoff, then you don't have to worry.
So nobody's made it compulsory.
Yeah.
And I think that's because of the price point, and we understand that. You wouldn't typically make a 6,000 rupee test compulsory in India. But a lot of them recommend it. I work closely with Ashoka, and I know that a lot of the high caliber candidates who are applying to Ashoka do apply with SAT scores.
So what happens, for example, at Ashoka is they will confirm the admission before final IB scores if you have the SAT and they're admitting you. While if you don't have the SAT and you're waiting, you've done their interviews, etc., then they hold on till your final IB comes. So you have admission, but confirmation only comes after. So that's one advantage. I also wanted to say there are a number of European universities that also do this. They will say we accept the SAT instead of our test, or if you have this cutoff, pretty much that's the benchmark you're in.
Okay, fantastic. So the use really is outside of the US now as well. Even universities in Singapore and Hong Kong consider SAT scores as well. So again, would encourage your students to do research. A lot of students ask me, I'm applying only to the UK. Do I need to take the SAT? Answer is probably not, because UK universities don't require it. However, I always tell students, if you're applying to multiple countries, so if you're applying to US and another country, and if you've anyway taken the SAT and if you've done very well, there's no harm in sharing your score. But don't take the exam just because your friends are taking it if your country doesn't require you to take it, you know, the country that you want to go study in. So, yeah. Great. I think it's 9:02, so we'll wrap up. Thank you so much for coming in. I hope that was useful. Happy to stay back and take any questions you may have. Thank you.